Okay, this starts the next video series. This is actually video number 9, entitled The Dying Experience. Looking at some of the popular beliefs, examining some of the research. Now, along with this day, there is another discussion question. I want to remind you of that. And what I want to kind of talk about as a group, between all the students and myself, getting on and using the forum of the discussion to basically go through this question here. If a person's having a lot of pain related to the dying process, what can be done to basically help them? Okay, so I want to, in the dying process, in the dying experience, and this is what this session is over, is the dying experience. For a discussion question, I wanted to basically emphasize or specialize or go more into our discussion about the one part of the whole dying process, pain, that is basically related. Not only physical, but spiritual, emotional, social, you know, whatever. Physical pain, of course, is where we talk, you know, most of our emphasis about. But as far as the dying process, the dying experience, okay? Let's kind of zero in for a moment on a person with Alzheimer's. Okay, the dying experience related to an individual with Alzheimer's. Now, Alzheimer's is simply a series of forgetting. Okay, you're going to read some books that talk about the 4 stages of Alzheimer's. You're going to read other books that talk about the 7 stages of Alzheimer's, and I'm sure in a couple years another book will be written about the 9 or 10 stages of Alzheimer's, okay? For simplicity and understanding, right now I'm going to stick with the 4 stages of Alzheimer's, okay? Because it can easily be understood. Now again, remember, like I said, in the dying experience, and of course Alzheimer's is a terminal disease. Different people are in different stages of it, of course, you know, some nearer than others to the end of their life. But anyways, in Alzheimer's, and you've heard of the saying before, I'm sure, alert and oriented times 3. Well, what is the oriented times 3? Well, that is basically oriented to person, time, and place. Person, do they know who that individual is over there in the corner? Do they know their grandchild or not? So that's the person. Time, do they know the day of the week? Do they know the month, the year? And then place, of course, do they know where they are currently at? Well, Alzheimer's into 4 stages. In stage 1, the Alzheimer's individual will forget things that are related to time. They'll forget about an appointment that they had today. They'll forget that they were supposed to be somewhere this afternoon at 2 o'clock. Different things that are related to time orientation, they will start to forget about. And in stage 1, it's kind of hard to pick this up, because in the normal aging process, the brain shrinks about 15% when somebody gets in their 70s and 80s and 90s. So with that shrinking of the brain, normally 15%, comes short-term memory loss. So a lot of times it's hard to really distinguish, is this Alzheimer's or is this just normal aging? Now when it goes to stage 2, now it becomes a little bit more obvious that there is an issue here that is not normal aging. Because in stage 2, they forget things that are related to place. They may be driving from one part of town, going to another part of town to go shopping, and the police bring them back from another city 20 miles away. Okay, that's pretty obvious when the police have to bring back grandma or grandpa that something is wrong. So in stage 2, they forget things that are related to place. And they'll even forget where their own bathroom's at in their house sometimes. Now in stage 3, the progression goes on, And in stage three, they forget things that are related to person. They'll look at a spouse. Who are you? They'll look at a grandchild. Who are you? Who are you? They will totally forget things that are related to person. And then finally in stage four, now this is where they enter more into the active dying process in stage four. This is where the body forgets how to work. The epiglottis that covers over the trachea like lightning every time you swallow, well, it forgets how to close sometimes, or it closes real slow, or it only partially closes, leaving the trachea exposed, and food or fluid can go down the trachea into the lungs, which of course is aspiration, which will very potentially lead to aspiration pneumonia. The gut forgets how to work. The gut, of course, breaks down food. You know, everything we eat, everything that we drink, you know, goes to the stomach. The stomach churns it all up and changes its consistency to what's called chyme. And chyme is a semi-solid liquid, mush, kind of like, that leaves the stomach and starts to travel through our small intestine and our large intestine. And what we have in this chyme is our six essential nutrients: proteins, carbohydrates, fats, vitamins, minerals, and of course water. Well, the small intestine absorbs the first five mostly. Does absorb a little bit of water, but mostly the proteins, building block of new tissue, the carbohydrates and fats for energy, carbs for quicker energy, fats for more sustained energy, vitamins and minerals to the chemicals to help run our body, and most of our water is reabsorbed in the large intestine. Well, and it gets absorbed through the intestine, goes into the bloodstream, and once these nutrients get into the bloodstream, our bloodstream distributes them through our body to feed our organs, to bring nourishment to our organs. Well, what happens in the gut, it forgets how to do that whole process, so the nutrition that the person should be getting, it doesn't work because the whole system, the whole GI system is forgetting how to function, how to work. Malnutrition is inevitable. What usually takes the life of an Alzheimer's patient is the immune system forgets how to work. This also is, you know, what happens in an AIDS patient. In an AIDS patient, the immune system doesn't work because of failure, because of the disease process. Well, in Alzheimer's, it just forgets how to work. The end result is basically the same. A person does not have a functioning immune system. And our immune system, of course, is what protects us from, you know, any pathogens that are out there that try to invade into our body. That's why a lot of Alzheimer's patients, and also a fair number of AIDS patients, pneumonia will be the causative, you know, reason for their death. So in the dying process, in the neurological system, this is what we see a lot for the process, the dying experience, you know, for our Alzheimer's patients, is this kind of a journey. So like I said, once they get into the terminal stage and they are having swallowing difficulties, they're having nutritional difficulties, and then of course the immune system starts to fail, you can kind of see what type of support they're going to need for help with eating, careful eating, thickened liquids, with the gut forgetting how to work, maybe nutrition supplements and things like that, the immune system protecting them from disease as much as possible, and of course protecting them from nosocomial infections, which is hospital acquired infections that basically, just because staff's not washing their hands enough, they carry a pathogen from one patient to another. Now, the dying experience, so that was the dying experience neurological. The dying experience like cardiac, okay? Multiple heart attacks, coronary artery disease, where the arteries in the heart are plugged up either by blood or by fat, and a person has a number of heart attacks. And different heart diseases will, most all of them will end up at one location, and that one location is CHF, congestive heart failure. Not all of them, but a lot of them do, congestive heart failure. And the nickname for congestive heart failure is pooped pump syndrome. Because all the heart is a pump. It pushes your blood along, okay? And it just gets tired, it gets wore out. That's why it's called poop pump syndrome. Heart beats about a million times a month. So you have a person that is 80, 90 years old, their hearts beat a lot, and it's exhausted, it's tired. But it don't have to be a young person. It can be an old person. It can be a younger person with a congenital issue that changes the function of the heart, and as far as its ability to pump, makes it seem like maybe it's only 15 years old, but it makes it seem like the heart is really 80 years old. So what we see a lot, like I said, is congestive heart failure in the cardiac realm in the dying process, where the heart is just not beating very strong. And one of the things, of course, that we start to see is fluid buildup. Because as the heart's not beating strong, it's not pushing the fluid along strong enough, and it'll just start to more and more and more accumulate. Well, we'll start to see a puffiness on the top of the person's foot. From there, the puffiness will progress to not only being on top of their foot, but around their ankle. And the puffiness will be so much accumulated, you could, if this were a person's leg and this were their foot, you could push your finger on their ankle and you leave a pit mark or indentation. From there, the fluid will back up the leg. It'll make the leg so engorged it'll be very hard, and then also can weep out some of the fluid. And eventually, as the fluid crosses the belt line, the waistline, the fluid will start to now back up and fill either the heart, fill around the heart, or fill the person's lungs. And they'll start to manifest pulmonary edema, where you hear a gurgling when they're breathing in and out, where you hear a bubbling sound, or if it accumulates around the heart, see, because the heart should just beat like this. Okay, now picture a person coming up here and holding their hands around my hands really hard. Okay, and I probably could not do this. I could probably only barely do this. Well, that is to symbolize water around the heart, that it like a vice, it clamps down on the heart, and of course then the heart can't beat very well. And this is what we see in congestive heart failure, as the congestion builds up. Or like I said, the pulmonary edema will start to happen. And as they're breathing, you can hear them gurgling. If the pulmonary edema gets really large, they'll have frothy edema, where, you know, bubbles will kind of roll out their mouth. And when that happens, you know the lungs are really full of liquid. Some people will get ascites with congestive heart failure. They'll also get it with end-stage liver disease also. But ascites is a fluid buildup in the abdominal, you know, tissue. And if you've ever thrown a rock into a still pond, you know how it kind of ripples out. Well, what happens here in the abdominal tissue, if you just tap it on one end, the fluid will ripple back and forth several times because the abdomen is so full of fluid, this ascites. And a lot of times when we see this ascites, we kind of know the end is getting closer and closer and closer. So as the dying process, this is cardiac. They could have chest pain, that will need to be taken care of. They will have trouble breathing. So interventions will need to be done for chest pain, for comfort, not for cure, but for comfort, you know, and then of course, you know, for fluid buildup, interventions to help them breathe easier. The other, you know, going on to the lungs in the diet experience, well, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, emphysema, asthma, lung cancer, as these things go on, it's just obvious that a person's going to have more and more and more difficulty breathing. So the interventions for these folks are going to have to be comfort measures with their breathing. Some of the little things will help, you know, raising the head of the bed up, the fan on the face like we talked about the other day, with the oxygen sensors in the skin around the mouth. The air currents will stimulate that and activate them for a sense of easier breathing. But a lot of times, the breathing will get so intense that the only peace we can offer them is through meds. There are certain meds that if they're, you know, breathing like that, that morphine and some of the other meds will slow that breathing down and relax them. Not trying to hasten their death, but just trying to help them be comfortable. It's kind of like, you know, I don't know how you are when you go to the dentist. I know how I am. I'm sitting in the chair, I'm nervous. They make a noise behind me, I'm going to be turning around and looking what's going on, okay? I just don't do well at the dentist, okay? And that's, you know, kind of normal. We're all afraid of the unknown to some extent. Well, what's more unknown than death and dying? So the person could be reacting to this in fear. So what's the dentist going to do? It's going to give me something to calm down. What do we do for the patient with death and dying? We give them something to calm down. So that's what I mean. That's when we talk about what's called palliative sedation. Sedating the person in a palliative way to basically help them relax so they're not going through the suffering, anxiety of the terminal restlessness or the terminal dyspnea that a lot of people face when different things like this happen, to help people in that way. So our pulmonary or our dying pulmonary patients, we can do things to help them. And like I said, as far as your cardiac, your patient that has a bad heart is going to have a very difficult time lying in bed on their left side. They will not feel well there. On their back flat with the head up a little bit, or on their right side with the heart upward, they will feel better. Now, any of your folks that are dying of cardiac or pulmonary problems, always expect them and be prepared for this, to expect them to have a harder time breathing with a rapid weather change, or if it's a neurological situation going on, like an Alzheimer's, expect them to have a rougher time with a full moon. Both of these, increased gravitational pull related to a full moon, or barometric pressure changes, atmospheric pressure changes with a rapid weather change, are going to have an effect on our body. You may know folks that have arthritis. They're not dying, but they've just got arthritis. And they'll talk to you about that. A weather change coming in, they ache more in their knees or something like that. You know people with maybe that have bad migraine headaches, they're going to talk to you about the headache is worse on a full moon. Well, it's the increased gravitational pull from the full moon, and it is the pressure changes inside the thoracic cavity, pleural, cardiac, that change due to the barometric pressure changes with the weather. So you can expect those folks to have more of a difficult time and to get ready for those changes that they may have. You know, your Alzheimer's patient may be more confused, more hallucinations, more pain and more headaches. Your cardiac, your pulmonary patients, more breathing difficulties. People with the dying process with the GI system expect more and more nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. difficulty eating, food just doesn't taste as good, you know, they may do better with several small meals a day instead of three big meals, six smaller meals they may do better with. And like I said, it with GI, you know, like a stomach cancer or a colon cancer or something like that, expect them to have a lot of nausea and vomiting issues, a lot of diarrhea issues. Folks with renal failure, well, the kidneys clean the blood. They take out extra water from our blood if we have too much, and the kidneys regulate the pH of the blood. Well, the two things I want to talk about is cleaning the blood and the water balance, okay? Expect problems with that. The blood is not going to be cleaned as well with the person with end-stage renal disease. So our blood has a bunch of poisons in them, you know? If you go out and play some basketball or play some tennis or jog, your muscles are going to put out a product called lactic acid. You're going to drink your water or your sports drink, and like an hour later you're going to urinate. Well, your kidneys have cleaned out the lactic acid from your blood, which was a result of muscle activity, and got this poison out of your body. The person with end-stage renal disease, this doesn't happen as much, or happen very well at all, depending on what stage they are in the end-stage renal disease. So the lactic acid stays in and it starts to burn, and acid, of course, burns. You know, that you know. So it's going to start to burn vital organs in the body. So you can start to expect in an end-stage renal disease dying experience patient the poison staying in the body and causing them problems. Same with the water. You can expect the water, the water balance, that the role of the kidneys do. No, there's going to be more water, more and more water staying in the blood. And when that happens, that's going to make the blood pressure goes up because it's going to have to make the heart to beat basically stronger. Pain, of course, in the dying experience is one of our main controlling problems. We have things today, though, that work very well. The duragesic patches, the pain patch people will call it, it's fentanyl, works very well. Stays on a person for about 3 days, you change it every 72 hours. If you're in the nursing area or involved in putting these pain patches on somebody, be very remembering of they need to be put on where the person has some adipose or fat tissue. That's how the medication absorbs into the body. If somebody on their chest is like very thin and their ribs are showing,